When most people think of nitrous oxide, they probably think of the Fast and the Furious movies and think back to Brian O'Connor pulling what seems like 15 gears along a quarter mile run that takes about 30 seconds. Well, we're here to show you that there are some legitimate uses for nitrous oxide outside of the movies and drag racing. Behind me is Tony Quinn's Highlands Motorsport Park Ford Focus hill climb car that competes in the Unlimited class at Pikes Peak. Last year, we found that despite the relatively small-sized Garrett GT30 turbos fitted to the Nissan VR38 engine, at Pike's Peak, we suffered from a huge amount of turbo lag. Here on our dyno at close to sea level, we were seeing full boost by around about 4,000 RPM. However, at the very high altitude at Pike's Peak, we were seeing a lot more lag and the turbos weren't reaching full boost until 5 or 5,500 RPM. Now, particularly in the centre section of Pike's Peak, this was really hurting the car as there's a lot of very slow first and second gear switchback hairpins. The driver would go to full throttle and it would take as much as a full second for the turbos to reach full boost. After analysing the problem, we decided to fit a small nitrous kit to the car for the 2018 running of the Pike's Peak International Hill Climb. Nitrous works by injecting oxygen straight into the intake system where it makes its way into the cylinders. By chemically adding additional oxygen, we can then add additional fuel. This results in a larger combustion charge and produces more power from the engine. With a turbocharged engine, it also has the added benefit of producing increased exhaust flow, and this helps spool up the turbochargers, bringing them on boost much faster. In order to make a full bottle of nitrous last one run, we're using the nitrous solely for anti-lag, and this is all controlled through the MoTeC ECU. I'm going to explain exactly how that works. Let's start though by talking about the components of the nitrous system. This starts right at the back of the car with the 12-pound carbon fibre nitrous bottle. The carbon fibre bottle is not a particularly common choice, but it does save a lot of weight compared to the conventional aluminium bottle. It's mounted at the rear of the car simply because this was one of the few places where there was enough space to mount the bottle securely and safely. Moving forward from the nitrous bottle, we have a nitrous filter. Now this just makes sure that the very small nitrous jets aren't going to be blocked if there's any foreign material or debris in the nitrous system. You can also see that there is a pressure sensor fitted to the nitrous filter inlet, and this is connected up to the MoTeC ECU. This particular sensor can read up to 2000 PSI. I'll talk more about why we've got that in a moment. Moving forward from the nitrous filter, we move up to the Cheater Solenoid. This is a NOS product, and this is what the ECU activates in order to actually spray nitrous into the engine. Because the VR38 runs two inlets with twin throttle bodies, we've had to tee the nitrous feed off that solenoid, and we're running two individual nitrous jets. Now this system is what's referred to as a dry nitrous installation, where we are only adding the nitrous itself through that solenoid. When we inject the nitrous, however, we do need to add additional fuel to maintain a safe air-fuel ratio. We're also going to potentially need to retard the ignition timing as well. This is all handled seamlessly through the MoTeC's nitrous control strategy. Around the nitrous bottle, you can also see we've installed a bottle heater. Now, this is just like an electric blanket for your nitrous bottle. The idea here is that the heater heats up the nitrous gas inside the bottle in order to achieve and maintain a consistent pressure in the bottle. It's really important to try and maintain a consistent pressure in the bottle to ensure that you get optimum performance as well as consistency out of the nitrous kit. The nitrous system is all controlled electronically via the MoTeC M150 ECU. Starting with the bottle heater, the ECU is monitoring the bottle pressure, and via the MoTeC PDM or power distribution module, the ECU can trigger a power supply to the heater to turn the heater on until the bottle reaches its optimum pressure of approximately 950 psi or 65 bar. Once that pressure is achieved, the ECU then tells the PDM to switch off the power to the nitrous heater. The nitrous heater control is used both prior to a run up Pike's Peak as well as during the competition run itself. The ECU also has a range of parameters that define when the nitrous will actually be injected into the engine. And we can use these to make sure that the nitrous only sprays exactly when we want it to. In this case, we're using trigger points for both throttle position and engine RPM. We're limiting the nitrous flow so it will only inject when the driver is above 90% throttle and the engine RPM is above 3500. For our anti-lag strategy, we also want to then switch the nitrous off as soon as we reach a preset boost level. Now, unfortunately, we couldn't actually do this with the standard MoTeC package and we had to get a little creative. In this case, because the car is also fitted with a MoTeC C125 dash, we created a user condition inside the dash. This user condition looks at our manifold pressure, and we've also set it up to look at the driver boost position switch. This is a rotary switch that the driver can use to select the boost pressure setting. This allows us to deactivate the entire nitrous system at the lower boost pressure settings, and also deactivate the nitrous control once our boost pressure has reached our target. Now we're sending the result of this user condition out to the MoTeC M150 ECU via a CAN message. So with the interaction of the MoTeC M150 and that user condition in the C125 dash, we've got complete control over exactly when the nitrous activates and deactivates. The aim of this strategy is to only inject nitrous when the driver goes to full throttle but doesn't have sufficient boost. As soon as the nitrous is injected, the engine will produce more power, more exhaust gas, and this very quickly spools the turbos. As soon as the turbos come on boost, the nitrous can then be deactivated, and this means that the nitrous is only active for a very short period of time when the driver goes back to full throttle out of those tight, low-speed hairpin corners. We've got the car strapped down on our mainline dyno now, so we're going to jump in and get the system up and running. Completed the configuration and tuning of the nitrous system, and the results are in line with what we were hoping for. Here, with our facility being close to sea level, we're not seeing the true potential or advantage of the nitrous because we didn't really have problems with lag here in the first place. The true potential of the nitrous system is really going to show when the car heads to Pikes Peak next year. The main aim of our tuning exercise here was simply to ensure that the fueling and ignition timing were safe when the nitrous system was activated. In order to show how the nitrous system affects the boost response though, we have performed one run where we've activated the nitrous a little earlier than we intend to at Pikes Peak at just 3000 RPM. Here on the dyno you can see that the boost comes in earlier and we're making approximately an additional 25 kilowatts at the wheels through the mid-range here. Now that might not sound like an impressive figure, but we're expecting the effect of the nitrous system to be magnified at the 14,000 foot altitude of Pikes Peak, and in turn this should add up to a significantly faster run. We're looking forward to seeing how the car performs when it competes next.
If you liked that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson. You'll learn about performance engine building and EFI tuning, and you'll also have the chance to ask questions, which I'll be answering live. Remember, it's 100% free, so follow the link to claim your spot.